The book of John this morning. And we've been going book by book, chapter by chapter through John. This summer we're doing a lot of different topical things. We started John a few weeks ago. We're continuing through this gospel. It's a gospel of love. It's a gospel of showing the deity of Jesus. It's a wonderful, wonderful book. Now, last week we looked at the first miracle, the wedding in Canaan. We saw that there was a need, that Jesus responded to the need, and that we're going to have needs in our life. And that if we take our needs to the Lord, He knows them even before we ask, and He'll respond to our needs. Now listen, there's a difference between wants and needs, amen? Because if we got our wants, Derek Jeter and the Yankees would be in the playoffs today, amen? But they're not. So I have needs and wants. God responds to my needs, amen? And we saw last week that He doesn't always respond the way we want Him to respond. Because He's always in a fine-tuning and growing attitude with us. So we may want things to happen a certain way, but He may do it a different way because He's working something out in our life. We looked at that last week. That He knows us, that He responds to us, that there's a personal link with us. So this week, as we continue on, we're going to see one of the only accounts, one of the few accounts where we see Jesus display anger. And anger is one of the things we're not really used to associating Jesus with. It only really happens once or twice in the Word. But it's an interesting thing as we begin to look at His anger, why He was angered, and whether or not there is a righteous anger that we're allowed to have. And we're going to talk about the church, religion, relationship. We're going to see how these all apply to our lives. So I'm going to read today from John chapter 2, verse 13 and 25, just about 12 verses or so, and we're going to get into the Word of God. Amen? And it says this. It says, after He went down to Capernaum, and that was after the miracle at the wedding feast, people ask me all the time, do you believe it was real wine that He made? Yes. I believe that Jesus turned the water into real wine, not unfermented grape juice or something like that. Why do I say that? Because wine was a traditional thing at Jewish weddings. And they made a big claim about it. So I don't want to get into all the details, but yes, I believe Jesus drank wine. I believe He turned water into wine. I do not believe that He was ever drunk, though. Bible's clear. Okay, let's get into this. So, now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and He found in the temple those who sold oxen, sheep, and doves, and the money changers doing business. When He had made a whip of cords, He drove the money changers, He drove them all out of the temple, and with the sheep and the oxen, poured out the changers' money and overturned their tables. And He said to those who sold doves, take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of merchandise. Then His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house has eaten me up or has consumed me. So the Jews answered and said to Him, what sign do you show us since you do these things? And Jesus answered and said to them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Then the Jews said, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But He was speaking of the temple of His body. Therefore, when He had risen from the dead, His disciples remembered that He had said this to them, and they believed the Scripture and the word which Jesus had said. Now when He was in Jerusalem at Passover during the feast, many believed in His name, when they saw the signs which He did. But Jesus did not commit Himself to them, because He knew all men, and He had no need of anyone that anyone should testify of man, for He knew what was in man. Amen. Let's pray. So Father, we come before You in the name of Jesus. Thank You for Your word, Father, for in it we find truth and we find life, Lord. We ask that You open our hearts and our minds to receive what You would have for us this day. Father, I would ask once again, Lord, via the power of the Holy Spirit, Lord, not my words going forth, Father, but Your words flowing through me. We love You, Lord, and we praise You, and we give You the glory and the honor. In Jesus' precious name, amen. It's an interesting account here. at the end, a lot of people begin to believe in it. And more than one occasion, people begin to flock and mass after Jesus, and he doesn't, you know, give himself to them because he knows what the actual intent in the heart. Like when he fed the 5,000 and he fed the multitudes again, and they were just there for the food, for the blessing. And he's one who discerns the heart of men. And it's understand that Jesus has this discernment over people. And he sees something. And I want to take this back to the temple now. What's taking place here at the temple? Because you see him do something out of character. He takes a cord of whip. Somehow he takes something and he makes whips out of it. And he goes into the temple, into the outer courtyard, and he starts, whoosh, bang, cracking the whip, yelling at people, knocking over tables and money, and chasing people out of the temple of the living God. And you're like, wow, you know, what's going on here? Jesus is upset. Yeah, he's upset. Because something was taking place in there. Something that was not supposed to take place in there. Jesus is 30 years old now. And you have to understand this. This is the beginning of his earthly ministry. He was baptized by John the Baptist as God was asking all the Jews to do. He got his first few disciples. We saw that as well. He's at the wedding. He does his first public miracle at the wedding of Cana. And now he's beginning his earthly ministry. Why did God wait for him to be 30 years old to begin his earthly ministry? I bring this up because he had been to the temple before. He had been there before. He had been to Passover feast before. He's a grown man. He was required to be there like anybody else was required to be there. But at 30, now God starts his ministry. I don't have an answer for you why at 30. I know it lasts 3 years. I know this. And that day at 30 years old, you were well seasoned as a man. The life expectancy was probably around 50 or 60 in those days. But at 30 years old, you were well seasoned, you were well trained, you had been in life and experienced life, and we know that Jesus experienced everything we did. We know that he experienced letdown, pain, sorrow, that people died. We don't know what happened to his father, Joseph. What? Apparently he's not around, apparently he did die. We know that he experienced joy and laughter and everything that we all experienced in life. And that's the beauty of him. And at this point, he goes to the temple and he sees something that he's obviously seen since childhood. And now he makes a stand. And he begins to crack the whip and turn things over and cleanse, if you will, his father's temple there. It's interesting because he has emotions like you and I have emotions. Jesus cries. We see him weep. He weeps over Jerusalem. He weeps over Lazarus. He has anger. He has joy. And what you need to understand about Jesus as our Lord and Savior is that he was fully God. It says he stepped off the throne and he was fully man. And he can relate to us. He was well seasoned as a son, a carpenter, a Jewish man, a brother, a teacher. He experienced everything we did, yet he remained sinless. It says in Hebrews 4:14 this about him. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we were, yet without sin, or as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace in our time of need. The beauty of God, the beauty of having Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, as our high priest, is that we can go to him and he can relate. It's not like we're sitting down here with this impersonal God and we're like, hey God, you don't know how tough it is to be down here. You created this place with all this sin and stuff and we got to live here. You don't know what it's like. You know, you don't know why I'm doing the things I'm doing. No, he does. He fully understands. He fully experienced everything we have. And therefore, because of that, we can come before the throne of grace boldly. Not pridefully, boldly with assurance and confidence that He understands when I'm hurt. He understands that I have hopes and dreams. He understands that I have desires and wants. He understands that I'm struggling with this or that. And I'll get sympathy. I'll get an embrace. I'll get strength. I'll receive mercy and grace. And that's the beauty of our Lord. Now I bring this all up, his age and all this stuff again, because he's making a stand now. This is the beginning of his ministry. He's coming into his father's house officially, beginning his ministry, and he sees something. He comes in to challenge these religious rulers and begins to make points about what they had done with this faith that God had given them and what they're doing, the keepers of the faith, the keepers of this relationship with God, and how they're lording it over the people. And this is step one. And you're going to see this all through the Word of God, all through the Gospel. Jesus challenged these religious rulers and leaders, calling them hypocrites, challenging them on the things they're doing to the people. And this is a big, bold statement right here. He walks into the temple that's under the control of the priest. Now, you got to understand, in Israel, although they were occupied by the Romans let the people they conquered rule themselves. They had a king over them. That was Herod. But they basically let them govern themselves. The Jews weren't really governed at this time by a king. They had the puppet king, Herod, but they were governed by the priests, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the ruling religious body. It was a religious system. And now he goes into their turf, basically, and he flips the tables over, and he drives the people out. And they're indignant about that. This is the Passover celebration that's taking place right now. We've talked about the Passover. It's the time when the Jews came together and they celebrated the fact that in Egypt, the Lord would pass over the house, any house that had the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, and they would be spared from that time when all the firstborn were killed. And now he's there to celebrate this. Every Jewish male in the family were required to come up and bring a sacrifice and have the sacrifice made at the temple. This was a requirement of them. Now, he sees what's going on. He's tired of what he's seen. The misappropriation of the use of the temple, of this relationship with God. That men had turned this faith and this relationship into a religion. And they have lorded it over the people. And he begins to act out. He has a righteous anger. And when confronted by the religious rulers on what he's doing, they don't say to him, "Hey, you're wrong, stop." They don't say that to him. They say this, "What sign do you show us that you do these things?" In other words, they know he's not wrong in doing it. Matter of fact, they know that they're wrong in doing it. And they're not saying to him, "Hey, you're not right, get out of here." They're saying, "What sign, by what authority do you do the things that you do?" And he answers them this way. He says, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." And we know he's talking about his body. Hey, it took 46 years. Well, no. This one. On the third day, he's going to rise again. Our body is the temple of the living God. And on the third day, he'll rise again. And that will be testimony enough, proof enough of his godhood and his righteousness in cleaning this temple. He had a zeal for his father's house. His house was supposed to be a house of prayer, a place of worship, a place for a relationship between God and his people. And they had turned it into what? A place of merchandise or a den of thieves, it says. It's a place where we're to connect with our Heavenly Father and have that relationship. But it wasn't happening. It had become a religion. A religious place where religion was doled out to the people and for a price. Listen, it's sad because whenever you exchange a faith for a religion, you lose out. You get ripped off. And he was tired of the people getting ripped off here. And Matthew, you get further detail. This is what Matthew's account says this. It says, "Then Jesus went into the temple and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple, overturned the tables, the money changers, the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, 'It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer,'" one-on-one relationship place, "'but you have made it a den of thieves.' Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple, saying, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' claiming him as the Messiah, they were indignant." They were upset. "How dare you do that? How dare you take this praise? How dare you come in here and usurp our power?" They were indignant. Was it okay for Jesus to be angry? Yes. Anger is an emotion. That's all it is. Anger is an emotion. Pride is a sin. Jealousy is a sin. Hatred is a sin. Murder is a sin. Things that may all stem from anger. But anger is just an emotion that we have. And you're going to have anger. And this is a righteous anger. We are going to have anger when we experience unrighteous things. Was it okay? Yes. Ephesians 4:26 says, be angry and do not sin. Keep your anger in check. Matter of fact, it says, don't let your sun go down on your anger. In other words, you need to deal with it before you go to bed. Don't go to bed and wake up angry even more. And I don't mean that, you know, don't be angry and you know, be angry the next day. You know, I mean, deal with it at night. In other words, settle in your heart. And if you can settle the situation with the person before the sun sets, that's the best thing. I know that when I settle things in my heart, when I decide to let it go for a day, and you have to settle. Otherwise, if you stay angry for a day and the next day the anger burns and it leads to stuff. But when you settle, okay, maybe I don't know, maybe I need to let this go, Lord, you help me, and you sleep on it, the next day it's, when it happens, it's this. It's that knee-jerk reaction. When I'm in Walmart and I'm about to pull in the parking lot and someone cuts me off, you know, I got anger, you know. I'm thinking, you know, all right, Lord, you know, and I let it go. When something really happens and you've been slighted or insulted and you let it go and you sit on it, really you begin to look at the whole thing of life and you think, yeah, what's really a big deal? Now listen, after a guy like Alex comes and shares how he went to prison and forgave the guys who killed his family, I got nothing to say about anger, okay? I got nothing to say. I let it quell my anger real quick. That's true grace and mercy. But if we don't keep our anger in check, that's when sin begins to breed. And that's what happens with Jesus and these people. Their anger is not kept in check, and it breeds sin. And it leads to all different kinds of things in relationship with Jesus. Do we experience righteous anger? Yes. Let me give you an example. About 22, 24 years ago, I'm in Kauai town. I'm with Elisa, I'm with another couple, I can't remember. We're walking at Sui Opera Store. We parked by Sui Opera Store in the parking lot. We're walking over to Sui Opera Store, and there comes this guy. And he's handing out pamphlets in the parking lot. And he hands me a pamphlet, and it's got a hand-drawn picture of a woman, naked, her hair coming down here, you know. And it says, Rachel Price, the sexy goddess of love. He's like, oh, you know, we got to do the church. And I'm like, dude, come on, man. Are you kidding me? Get out of here. He's like, oh, no, man, you know, it's okay. I'm like, Rachel Price? I don't think Jesus was married. It's okay if you're still under bondage, brother. It's okay. I'm like, you know. So, I walk in Sui Opera Store, and that's just that. Okay, dude, if you want to believe that, that's fine. You want to pump that to people, that's fine. I mean, if that's what you want to do. But while I'm checking out, I look, and I see the guy outside, and he's got two little girls on a bicycle. And he's giving them this literature, which in it, talks about free love and free sex and everybody can be with everybody and it's all good and it's this thing. You know, then I really get upset. And I run out there and I'm like, hey, come here, give me that. And I snatch it out of the kid's hand. Hey, you guys, go ahead. I'm like, hey, bro, I see you pumping this to kids, man. This is before I was as refined as I am today, okay? I had some choice words for the guy. I see you do this again, bro. Man, I'm gonna dump your butt right here, man. What? And he starts going off, and then he tells me he's the angel Gabriel and stuff like that. I had anger, and I sinned. I had to repent. I got upset at the guy. But the emotion of seeing someone trying to hurt little children, you know, is an anger. There's a righteous anger that comes up. And we are to be angry, yet not. Sin, this is the key. So Jesus is perfectly within his bounds. More so because it has to do with his Father's house. What Jesus saw was Israel's relationship with their God, what it had become, instead of a faith and a place of worship where people come and the priests minister and bless the people, to a place of lording power over the people, to a place of control and manipulation over the people. And that drove him crazy, in a sense. God had given them a faith. These people had taken it and made it a religion, and they were taking advantage of the people. Listen, Passover, which is going on at this time, is linked with another feast that comes 7 days later. It's Passover, and then it is the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The Feast of Unleavened Bread was able to make their bread quick without leaven, without it rising, because they were in haste to get out of it. But what you did during the Feast of Unleavened Bread that came 7 days later was this, that you would go into your house and you would clear out any leaven. They use leaven to bake bread. That's what makes it rise. But during this feast, you would go into your house, every cupboard, every bowl, every place, you would make sure there was no leaven in your house. And leaven is representative in the Word of God as sin. You were cleansing out your house and cleansing out the sin. Now Jesus comes to his Father's house and he's cleansing out the leaven. And he's cleansing out the sin. And he's getting rid of the things that shouldn't be there. And he's overturning tables. Listen, let me explain to you what's going on here from early scholars and writings during that time. As a Jewish male, you needed to bring your family up to the Temple of Passover. So you could travel from all over. You could travel from as far away as you were as a Jew. The bottom line is that as you're coming, as you see that in Acts chapter 2, during Pentecost, when they come from all these different places and they each hear the disciples talk in their language. So they're coming from all over. Now, your job was to bring a sacrifice. Now, God was cool about this. You could have a ram, a sheep, if you couldn't afford a sheep or something like that, you could have a turtle dove, something simple. But it had to be without spot and blemish. And the reason for that is we were to give our first and our best to the Lord. So if I have sheep or whatever, cattle, whatever, calf, I don't take the one that's all messed up that I'm not going to use and say, well, I'll bring this one up there and, you know, I'm not going to use it anyway. Because now we're not giving to God something that cost us, something that's, you know, from us. We're giving him a defect. So the rule was, or the law was, you bring a lamb, you bring an animal that has no spot or blemish. Why? Because I'm going to give my first and my best to God. Why? Because he gives me everything. So the priests were to, in order to keep this in a right way, and to keep the people right, the priests were to look at those animals and see if there was a spotted defect and say, sorry, you know, this thing's missing a hoof. You cannot, you need to bring another one. Because this isn't acceptable to the Lord. But what it had become was this. Everybody, almost everybody that brought their animal had a defect, had a spot. They'd look, they'd flip over the arm. Oh, hey, there's a mark. Oh, you know, this thing's not, the teeth are wrong. It's not, you know what? No good, no good. Rejection, 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 rejection. But for you, because I know it's going to be hard for you to go back home and get another one, Passover's now. Could you imagine all these thousands of people coming into the temple and hundreds of them having defective animals and trying to find spotless ones and having to run out and do this? And the priests are like, but we have pre-approved animals over here that already have been inspected. And for a small price, you can buy one. Now, there was no small price. Number one, they hyped up what it would cost. If it cost you 10 shekels or 10 denarius to have a turtle dove or a sheep or something like that, if that's what it was, they charge you 20. So now you would get the bad exchange. And on top of that, they said, no, the Roman money is no good. It's cursed money. So you get to have temple money, so there was an exchange. So not only did you lose out in the cost of the animal, but you lost out in the exchange rate. So it cost 10 temple dollars for this dove that you can get for 5. So you go to give him 10 Roman coins, 10 denarii, says, oh, no. There's an exchange rate. You need to give us 15. So they get you in both ways. Now the people are getting ripped off. They come to worship God. These guys are in control, complete power. They're manipulating people, and they're making money off the worship of God. And that's what sets Jesus off. And he's seen it enough, and he's had enough. And he, bang, get out. We're done. Hey, what authority? Hey, I'll show you an authority. In 3 days, I'll rise again. And they'll know that, and they'll see that. Listen, in doing what they did, they made God's house, which was supposed to be a house of prayer, a place of relationship, a place of worship, where people connect with God, to a den of thieves, where the people were getting ripped off spiritually and financially. And this is what happens when man is in control. And you see what happens, he clears them out. And what takes place after he clears them out? The lame, the sick, the blind come to him, and why? They get healed. They get ministered to. Why? Because that's what God's house is supposed to be for. You know, people church shop all the time. They'll go to a church and say, well, how's the youth? They'll go to a church, oh, how's the Christmas choir? How's the donuts? How's the coffee? What kind of amenities do they have? You know what we're told? We're told to enter into his house with what? Thanksgiving and praise. We're always looking at what we can get out. But what are we bringing into God's house? The right heart, the right attitude. And there are churches out there that merchandise today. There are. There's a famous speaker, he writes best-selling books. You'd know his name if I told you, I'm not going to tell you. But he was in Vegas last year doing a, whatever he does, a service, and you paid per seat. If you were in the front row, it was $300. If you were in the second mezzanine level, it was $40. I'm thinking about doing that, by the way. Guys in the front row should pay more. Can you believe that? Can you believe this? This guy's a bestseller. Bestseller. And he charges people like a rock concert. And he lived in large. It's not what Jesus is about. It's not what the Word of God says. And they don't, by the way, teach the Word of God over there. They dance around it. It was evident to the children who Jesus was. He was the Messiah. They weren't defiled by the world and all the stuff that happens. Children are beautiful, man, because they're not polluted by the world. But the rulers, the priests, the head guys, they were upset and indignant. It's that same jealousy and that fear that's going to cause them to accuse him when he heals somebody on the Sabbath and put him on the cross and kill him. Because they're afraid of losing their power and control over the people. They had an anger and they feared him, and it came about hate and jealousy and pride came with it. Jesus had an anger, and yet he loved them. And on the cross he said, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. This is why Pastor Tom couldn't be God. Amen? I'd be up there, lightning bolts from my finger. Yo, put me up there. Ha, 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 ha. Not Jesus. Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. He had anger but had love. They had anger but had hate. Amazing. Amazing. It's religion. And there's a big difference, guys, between religion and relationship. More people are hurt. More people don't go to the house of God because money changes, because of men, because of these things that have been instituted that were never in God's Word. We had a girl come in here Thursday night. I hadn't been in church in 14 years. I went when I was a young kid for my grandmother. And she said, yeah, I was a little worried if I was going to get judged coming in here and whatnot. And I was sharing to her about me and Delisa when we first met. And we were out. God knows what we were doing, man. We were off the wall and getting drunk and doing all sorts of things. And then we would wake up later and we would read the Bible. And that's the craziest thing. Hold of the drunk and skip that one, you know, and all the other sins. But what I saw for the first time in my life, it was just me and my wife there. You know, we were a boyfriend, girlfriend at the time. Was, man, I started noticing that a lot of stuff ain't in here. Where's this confessional? There's no confessional in here. Where's purgatory? That's not in there. Where's me saying these 15, 30 prayers? And as a young Catholic boy, I'd be up there for hours at the confessional, right? I'd be saying all sorts of things. All right, that'll be 8 a.m., that is, and 3, you know. Some Irish priest would have me on my knees for like hours, man, you know. And you think I was praying, oh, Father, I'll never be there. And I'm rifling mindlessly through these things because somehow, if I've achieved a number, the golden number, whatever it is, this guy did for me, then I'm forgiven. It's not in there. Holy cow, it is not in there. All I got to do is ask the Lord and I'm forgiven. Not only that, Father Murphy remembers my sins, Jesus doesn't, amen? Yeah. Yeah. How you doing, Father Murphy? Fine, son. How's that pickpocketing problem of yours? I thought that was between me and you. It's just not in there. Men institute things and take faith and make religion out of it. Listen, there's a big difference between religion and Christianity, religion and faith, between denominational church affiliations, bishops, deacons, popes, and a relationship with God, our Father. What do you think if you wind up on a desert island somewhere, your plane crashes, it's you and God, and you can't do the church rituals, you're going to go to hell? It's man-made stuff. Listen, and you have to understand, because of our sinful nature, that we are self-centered. If we don't check ourselves and ask the Lord to look into our hearts, we're prone to do the same things, to turn a faith into a religion and become ritualistic and routine and traditional. I was born an Italian Catholic kid because my father was one, and my mother was one, and my grandparents were one, and they were one, and they were one, and they were one as far back, and you know, okay, this is who you are, dude, okay. You know, I'm going through the motions like everybody else. I know this is going to freak you out. And listen, man has to keep his fingers out of God's pie. Because that's how religion starts. And we think we need to help God along the way. I don't want to burst your bubble today. I don't want to freak you out today. I don't want to lower your self-esteem today. But I'm going to tell you something. God doesn't need your help. Amen? God doesn't need my help. Amen? Matter of fact, if we start helping him, we mess things up. I figured out a long time ago how things work. Here's how it works. He's the head chef. I'm the head waiter. He prepares the meal, I deliver the meal. As long as I stay out of the kitchen, everything's okay, amen? But when I get in and I want to help God, no, you're not helping me, get out of here. All you're going to do is mess it up. We got to let God be God. We got to let His Word be His Word. We got to get away from religion. If we just do what He wants, we'll be fine. Do you remember what Mary said last week to the servants? Whatever He says, do it. What hurts people is what men say, what rules they institute over God's people. And then they get hurt by them. Let me tell you something. The Jews could not keep to the law. They couldn't do it. You know what the law was good for? You know what the purpose of the law was for? Was to show us that we're sinners and we can't keep the law. You can't do it. You can't keep the Ten Commandments. You can't keep the laws. It's plain. It's spoken of. It's told. And if you think you could, like these religious guys who said they could do it, who said they were better than everybody else, higher than everybody else, greater than everybody else, Jesus took them back up and said, I say, if you even think it, you did it. Woo! You're done. You're done. Everybody has bad thoughts. Everybody thinks it. He said, if you think it, you did it. You don't have to kill somebody. You don't have to cheat on your wife. You got to think it. It's done. You don't have to murder somebody physically. All you got to do is hate them. It's done. But He was pointing that out to show us that we need to be saved. And that's what the cross was. That our sins forgiven. He does it for us. We can't keep the law. We can't keep the rules. and men love to place rules and regulations. All he said is, you love me, you obey my commands. My burden is light. My yoke is easy. I didn't feel like the burdens were light and the yokes were easy when I was in that organized religious group growing up. I felt, man, you can't do nothing, you gotta be careful. I got pinched more times for goofing around with my brother than anything else. When I went up to get communion, it was like the Great Oz, amen? This imposing figure was there, the body of Christ. You know, stick your tongue out, and you'd have that stern look. You know, I felt like the lion, you know, I'm next, the body of Christ, don't mess up. I'm a little kid, there's no joy there. I flick holy water at my brother, bang, I'm in trouble. Because the water's holy, amen? It comes from a holy place, I don't know where, but imported somewhere where God stepped or something. And if you've been in Jerusalem or the seven churches of Revelation, we've been there. Any place they even think Jesus stepped has a gold icon on it, and there's a temple over it they're worshiping. We went into Patmos in Greece, and we went to a place they believe possibly John, the disciple John, may have slept. Now they believe possibly he may have slept there, so they built a huge cathedral over it. And this little cave where he may have laid his head on his cement, on this rock slab, they got a golden starburst crown on it. And then this little hole in the wall where he may have stuck his hand to get out of bed, they got another golden starburst on it. And do not take a picture, and do not touch it, and do not joke around. Last I checked, John was a guy like everybody else, amen? Even if he wasn't, he may have done it. You're spending billions of dollars for this, whatever it is. Don't look at it, don't touch it, don't take a picture. This is religion. Listen, Christianity is a faith. Mary said, whatever he says, do it. Christianity is a personal relationship with God. There's not a group effort involved. Listen, I'm not going to get into heaven because my team is better than the other team down the block. I'm not going to go to hell because someone in my team blew it. Dude, you forgot to light a candle. That's it, we're all out. It's not a group effort. It's individual, one-on-one. God created man, he put him in the garden, right? And what did he do? He walked in the garden. He talked with them, he had a relationship with them. Yes, sin came and separated. The whole thing has been trying to get that relationship back. Jesus makes that relationship back. Religion kills people. Keeps more people out of worshiping God than anything else, because in the name of Christianity, in the name of religion, what men have done, people get hurt. We blame God. Listen, it's just you and Jesus one-on-one with your Heavenly Father who provided a way of salvation for us by sending His only begotten Son to the cross to die for our sins. Listen, He did all the work. And this is what's confusing. It just seems too easy. Church has nothing to do with it. You coming here or not coming here has nothing to do with whether you're going to heaven or hell or whether you love Jesus or not. This is nothing. This is the gym. When you discover that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you make Him Lord and Savior of your life, and you have a personal relationship, then you get to go to church, and you get to see other people, and you get to pray with other people, and you get to praise together, and help, and work together, and support each other, and get strong, because church starts when you walk out the door, and you live your faith. Because people aren't coming in here. They're out there. Where the salt and the light. The salt has to get out of the salt shaker and get on the meat. Salt prevents meat from rotting. We have to get out and live our faith. That's what church is. This is just a gym. People have turned it into this mandatory thing. By the way, this group that I was with, I mentioned the name before, I will not anymore, but since I left, technically, officially, by the Pope, I'm going to hell. That's their doctrine. You leave, you go to hell. I don't think so, because my word tells me something different. And I'm not dissing the Pope. Listen, my grandmother's cousin was Pope Pius XII, Eugenio Vasselli. True story. My grandmother got packages from the Vatican. But what do we say? Pope's a regular guy. There's no hope in a Pope. He's no dope. But he can't help you cope. You heard it from me. Pope puts his pants on one leg at a time like everybody else. Here's the trick about the Pope. A day before he's the Pope, he's a regular guy. He can sin, he can all that stuff. The day he becomes a Pope, he's no longer a regular guy. He can't sin. What happened? Holy water. All I can think of. You know what, the Pope? This guy's a good guy. I like this guy they got now. I used to ride the bus with the people, a regular guy, but he's a guy. And there's nowhere in the Word of God that has this institution in place. And I'm not picking on the Catholics, it's just where I came out of. Listen, God did all the work for you. And when you mess with it, it's a masterpiece. It was done for you. And when you mess with it, you're messing with the masterpiece here. You try to make it something that it's not. It disappoints God. It upsets God. In James 3, chapter 1, it says, "My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment." Guys like me, guys who are put in charge, have to be very careful of how they represent God and what they institute, because we are going to be judged greater. Why? Because I'm putting you in charge of my sheep. Guess what? They're stinky, they're dirty, they run off, but they're mine, and I love them. And I die for them. Now I'm letting you be in charge. Do not beat them. Do not malnourish them. Do not trick them. Do not hurt them. Why? Because they're mine. So I'm responsible, as is everybody else who stands up and teaches God's word and leads a flock. It's a heavy thing. Listen. You cannot take what belongs to God and mold it into something made by men and come up with our own philosophies, rules, regulations that were never in God's word and institute them over the people to maintain control. That's religion. God doesn't need our help. He's already created a masterpiece at the cross. You can't add to that. It's already been done. You don't mess with masterpieces. Amen? You don't get a bunch of neon Sharpies going to the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City, walk up to the Monet and say, "It needs some lime green here." The Mona Lisa needs some lipstick and mascara. You're going to upset a lot of people, you're going to go to jail, amen? Although the Mona Lisa does need lipstick and mascara, you're not allowed to do that. It's been deemed a masterpiece. God already did it. God already did it, and religion wants to redo it. And I understand that the initial heart of religion at times is we got to help people. But it always gets perverted because we think that we need to help people in some way get to this place with God. But all it leads to is ungodly rules, regulations, stipulations, hierarchies, power and control that were never in the Word of God. As you read the Gospel, it's the craziest thing. As you read it, Jesus is fighting these guys for doing it. And in less than 100 years, or 200 years, we do it again. How many of you know this thing called the Lord's Prayer? We all know it. It's not the Lord's Prayer. What did he say? What does the Word of God say? The Word of God says this. Jesus said, "And do not be like the hypocrites who think their many prayers, their many repetitions will get their prayers answered. But when you pray, pray like this." Here's an example to follow. He didn't say, "When you pray, pray this prayer." He said, "Pray like this. Honor your Father who's in heaven. Holy is his name. Ask for his kingdom to come," because that's what we want. "Ask for his will to be done. Not my will. My will gets me in trouble. Provide my daily bread. Why today? Why not this week? Why not this month? Why not this year, my daily bread? Because I need to have a daily relationship with God. I need to look to Him daily. Forgive me of my sins, and here's the kicker. Forgive me, Lord. I want to be forgiven. We all want to be forgiven, right? How about this? As I forgive those who sin against me. In the same way I'm asking. In the same way I'm forgiving people, I'm asking you to forgive me. Wow, that makes me more forgiven. Forgive me, doesn't it? Lead me not into the place of temptation. Hey, Lord, don't let me go to a place where I'm going to get tempted, but deliver me from the evil one, for yours is the kingdom, power, and glory. The temple. He just said, don't do it. 2,000 years later, little Tommy Iannucci is in the box, and I'm getting like 80 of these. Oh, say 80, our fathers. Get up there now, you know. Somehow. But he just said, don't do it. The word of God is clear. But men create religion out of a faith. We have to be careful. Understand why Jesus was so upset and why he drove these people out of his father's house. It should have been a house of prayer where people were getting ministered to. It became a den of thieves where people were getting ripped off, making their faith so complex that they themselves couldn't follow their own faith. We're not going to get into it today, but we've gone into the law and the practices of the law and how ridiculous the law had become. You only walk so many feet. You couldn't spit on the ground because your saliva would turn into, go across dust, turn into mud. That's work. You made mud. All these little things. You couldn't light anything. It was trapped. Silly. Listen. Men make faith so complex, they turn it into a religion with rules, regulations, rituals that bind people up instead of a faith that frees people up. God is not looking for a bunch of mindless devotees. He's looking for individual relationships with you and with me because He knows you and He loves you and He knit you in your mother's womb and He knows what you need before you ask and He wants to have that personal relationship with you. This has nothing to do with it. I'm going to close with some scriptures here. And in these scriptures, I'm going to show you the freedom of a relationship between God and man. Scriptures that are going to show you that church is not supposed to be a burden, but it's supposed to be freedom, that a relationship with God is all He desires. From the Old Testament to the New Testament, I'm going to rifle through a few of them. First in Matthew 22:37, we're going to end with these scriptures. First in Matthew 22:37, a religious kid, a young guy asked, one of the rulers asked Jesus, hey, what's the greatest commandment? Trying to trip him up. Jesus sums up all the law right here. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it, that you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You treat people like you want to be treated. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. I could close right here, say amen, and go home. Really, it's about love. Love covers a multitude of sins. Love prefers one another. Love is patient. Love is kind. It's long-suffering. Micah 6:8. He has shown you, O man, what is good and what does the Lord require of you? But to find a good church, to follow the rules, to go by the hierarchy and the... No. What does the Lord require of you but to do justly, just before God, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? Personal. 1 Samuel 15:22. Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices? Has the Lord as great delight in these rituals, these feasts, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, to heed better than the fat of rams. In other words, there's people who go to church religiously and follow every single rule in the world, but they're not obedient to God. See, I'd rather you just be obedient, because what? It's a sign of love. If you love me, you obey my commandments. Hosea 6:6, for I desire mercy, not sacrifice. I desire to be merciful to people, not go through the motions. And the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings, a relationship. How about this guy? Genesis 5:22. And after he begot Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God and he was not, for God took him. He never died. God took him off the planet. Here's your commentary on Enoch in Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, by relationship, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death and was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. You gotta have faith. I'm in the Naval Hospital, I got a bad back, the Catholic chaplain comes through, grabs my card. Iannucci, Italian boy, yes sir, where are you from, New York? You're an Italian boy from New York, why aren't you a Catholic? I said, I'm just a Christian guy. Well, why is that? I said, I don't believe I gotta go through a bunch of people to get to God. He goes, let me tell you, son, it's like the Marines. You got your gunny, you got your sergeant, you got your captain, you got your colonel, you got your general. You go through the chain of command before you get to the top. Okay, Colonel, thanks. No. Enoch walked by faith. He walked with God. There was nobody between Enoch. We sang a song. There's nothing in between us. How about the thief on the cross? Never went to church. Was a sinner, never got baptized, never did anything, actually. The Romans felt that this guy was unworthy for life in their colony and their planet, but they decided that he was just worthy to die. He's on the cross dying next to Jesus. Here's the conversation right here, Luke 23, 42. Then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered and said to him, you have not gone through the proper rituals, my son, nor have you been baptized now. Assuredly, truly, I say to you, this day you will be with me in paradise. What did he do? He believed in his heart. He called Jesus Lord. Lord, when you enter the kingdom, what kingdom are you going to? Buddy, we're dying over here. Right? But he realized that Jesus Christ was Lord, and he was going to his heavenly kingdom. And hey, Lord, I'm sorry. You remember me. Hey, you'll be with me. No church, no rituals, one-on-one. That's the grace of God. And here, a few things real quick. This is the last scripture I'm going to share. Just real quick. Romans 10:8 says this. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth, in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Period. Not might be, could be, you will be. For with the heart one believes to righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. But there's no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So God's house shouldn't be a place of burden. It should be a place of freedom. A place to exercise our faith. Show me religion in any of those scriptures I just shared. Show me anything that talks about a hierarchy or a system anywhere. It's not there. Show me where it says I got to knock on doors or do good deeds or take classes or follow rituals. It's not there. Listen, you know what the problem is with Christianity? It's so simple. It's too good to be true. It's so simple, people like, they just can't be. That insults my ego as a non-believing God. Somehow I got to be involved in this process here. It can't just be God. Because I'm somebody. I got to do something. I got to earn it. No, it was done at the cross. And it doesn't compute to us. So it doesn't, it's so easy. I got to come up with these rules and things to keep everybody. It's not true. Because I'm somebody. My ego doesn't allow me not to get into heaven by my works, because I'm He's a fantastic God. Amen? We think high of ourselves unless we put things in there. So I can make achievements and I can pat myself on the back because look at me now, look at where I am now. Look. Yes. But nowhere in the scripture does it say that. Matter of fact, I am not really somebody because Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. So how can it be? How can it be that simple? Well, I'm going to talk about it next week, that famous sign they hold up at the football games. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. That's how it can be simple. He loved us before we loved him. For God so loved the world that even in my sins, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn it, but that through him the world might be saved. Whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but I'd be born. It's that simple. It's that simple. When we turn this place of God, this place of gathering together with brothers and sisters, into a place of regulations and rules and hierarchies and things and titles and positions and robes and bells and whistles that were not in the church, not with Jesus, that men instituted later, we take the beauty of a faith and we turn it into a religion. You know what, guys? Be careful in your heart that you haven't taken the faith and turned it into a religion. If you have, Jesus needs to come in and flip over some tables in your life. You need to let him come in and flip those things over because it's just about you and him. That's all he wants, your heart. And you know what? You'll be blessed. Because once that was cleared out, what happened? It was healing. Healing took place. It was praise. And that's what it is. Cannot make God's house a house, a den of thieves. You have to make it a house of prayer. When you come to church, what are you bringing in? You coming in with thanksgiving, praise on your lips? Are you looking to be spend time with the Lord and be blessed and refreshed? Are you looking for programs and positions and things like that? That's not God. He loves you so much. He died for you. He just wants a relationship with you. And this is just a box we come to and hang out and get strong. Church is out there. All the people who won't come in here. You be the salt. You be the light. You're going to be blessed and you're going to bless so many people along the way. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus. Just thank you for your word. Lord, forgive us at times when we make your church something that it never was. Lord, you just want a relationship. You just want hearts, Father. You just want one-on-one, Father, whether it's at the beach, Father, or in this building, Father, or in our backyard, Lord. You just want us to walk and talk with you, Father. Lord, forgive us if we've made your faith a religion. Forgive us if we've been hurt, Lord, and we've run away. Father, forgive us if we have not been men and women who just read your word and take you at what you are, Father, Savior, personal Lord and Savior. To help us to have eyes to see and ears to hear, Father. They shall know us by our love. If we love you, Lord, we'll obey you, Father. We won't be perfect, Lord, but we'll be forgiven. So help us, Lord, to bring forth the faith. Help us to set people free by doing away with the myth of religion and offer them a faith with a relationship with your Son. We thank you for this time. We praise you and we give you the glory and the honor. In Jesus' precious name, amen.